All praises to Yahweh, Hashem, Yahweh Shai, Hashem, Ahakadash. Double honor to the elders and apostles, chiefly of Great Millstone. We are the real Hebrew Israelites, consisting of the 12 tribes. We're not lost because we're somewhere out in the forest, or because, let's get the 12 tribes chart up. Not lost because we're somewhere out in the forest or somewhere in the deep in the Amazonian jungle in the deserts of Sahara. We're lost because we're a people that don't know who they are. 12 tribes are as follows. Let me see. Some variation, some of the ones I didn't really come that prepared today. Judah, which are the Negroes. Benjamin, the West Indians, Levi, which are the Haitians, Ephraim, which are the Puerto Ricans, Manasseh, which are the Cubans, Simeon, Dominicans, Zebulun, the Guatemalans, and the Panamanians, Gad, the Native American Indians, Reuben, the Seminole Indians, Asher, the Uruguayans, the Incas, Issachar, the Mexicans, Naphtali, Argentina, and the Chileans. I think that's all 12. So, well, yeah, we're here, we're waking up, as it's prophesied in Ezekiel 37, in the Valley of Dry Bones, where the bones will be made flesh, to have flesh put on them. We're slowly starting to get... See, bones represents something which is dead. That's in Ezekiel 37. I think we should get that to start off with. And then we'll go into Genesis. As I said, I was going to go into Genesis today to a brother who was breaking down Genesis. Let's get Ezekiel 37. Is it? The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me into the midst of the Lord, and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones. Bones represents dead. And they caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were many, many an open valley, and lo, they were dry. They were very dry. Means that they've been dead a long time. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord, thou knowest. Again he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and I will bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath on you. So the flesh and the sinew that goes upon the bones is understanding and life, and the breath is the understanding of the flesh and the sinews is just to be made alive, but the breath is the understanding of the way of the Father, this truth, this knowledge, this word. Having flesh put upon you is to be set in order and to be have a role to play, let's say, and then having the breath put upon you having the breath in you is to be breathed life into and to be able to understand. So if you have just flesh upon you, you're like a beast. You have a role to play. You have a beast of the field, but you don't have understanding, right? So this is going into Genesis chapter 3, and we can see a bit more of that. But I feel like I need to read a bit more of Ezekiel 37, from verse 3. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? Right, so then we know that the bones are dead, right? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. And again he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. So that it's not just... There's living and there's living, right? There's being, you know, having a heartbeat. But even, you know, Yahweh Shai said, you know, let the dead bury their dead. Now, how can the dead bury their dead? It's to live spiritually is to be aware of this truth and to be aware of the role you have to play. To have flesh put upon you is to be alive and to have a role. But you may be alive and but not know your role. You're kind of ignorant, like a beast of the field. And we'll go into that again in Genesis chapter 3. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring up flesh upon you. So, you'll come back to life, physical life, and cover you with skin and put breath in you. And breath is the understanding of the scriptures. And ye shall live, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanding. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. So, you know, his hand has skin and flesh on you. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, say unto the wind, thus saith the Lord of God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon thee slain, that they may live. Slain is, we'll go into that as well. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived. So when he prophesies unto the bones, when he started killing the, see, to prophesy is to speak forth. So when he, or to say forth, right, pro se. So when he started to prophesy and tell him, speak forth the word of this knowledge, this truth, the bones came to life, the breath was put upon them, and they lived. And the breath came into them, right? So if you prophesy, say, obviously, there's a sign that that's the breath is the understanding of the scriptures, right? Because if you prophesy onto something, that doesn't impart breath. That doesn't impart air. So we can see here that the metaphor for prophecy and or for breath is understanding of the scriptures. Then he said unto me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried and our hope is lost. We are cut off from our parts. Therefore prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, behold, all my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come out of your graves and bring you to the land of Israel. Now, this isn't a zombie movie. This is a spiritual reawakening of the house of Israel, which have, as I said earlier, are the blacks, Native Americans, and Seminole Indians, Mexicans, Guatemalans, Paraguayans, Haitians, West Indians. So this is the house of Israel, but we are lost because we are like dry, we are likened unto spiritually likened unto dry bones, where we don't know who we are, we don't know what we're doing, we don't know what role we're going to need to play, and we don't know this truth. You see, when the earth was created, the world was set in order, and one of the ways that you know that you're given an order and you're given your place in the grand scheme of things is to be given a name. We're going to go into that in Genesis. So we're going to go to Genesis chapter 3, maybe. Maybe Genesis chapter 2. And God said, 18, and God said, it's not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helpmeet for him. And out of the ground the Lord formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called them, every living creature, that was the name thereof. So the name is the purpose. This groundhog, or this is a flower fertilizer, you know, he gave them all these names. And these names were set in order. But you know, not only were they given names, but Adam was also given names. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and Adam became a living soul. So that's Genesis chapter 2. I think we're going to go to Genesis chapter 3 now, because I think there's something that we need to see there. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which God had made, and he said unto the woman, yea. So this is after Eve has been created and made into flesh from the rib of Adam, right? So we have to understand that Eve was is symbolic of the multitude of people. So we had the Adamites, who were the high priests, the people that really walked closely with God, and then there was other people, Eve, which were again of another nation, but they maybe weren't so, as close to God, and they were brought together in the form of the. It's like a priesthood, right? Where, you know, maybe where people, where the, you know, the populace serves this kind of high priesthood, and the relationship between them was actually unto of similar, had a similitude to the man and the woman, you know, and the flesh being put onto Eve was for her to be given her place in or these people to be given their place, the multitudes, one of the greatest the multitudes to be given a place in the world, and have you know, a role to play, which is mainly to be a helpmate. You see, the it's metaphorical, the relationship between the Adamites and what I might loosely call the church or the people of Israel at the time. Obviously, Israel wasn't there yet, but the multitude of the line of Abel or the line of Seth that were the righteous, they had a duty to be a helpmeet unto the priests. But then these people, they fell away, and they were beguiled by the seed of Cain. So it's kind of it's a little bit allegorical, because the seed of Cain, you know, if you look at it on a simple level, Cain was Eve's son, but in reality, these were people, these were lineages, and you had the Canaanites, who were a group of people that were like, that lived for a very long time. Like, even Adam's lifespan was about 930 years. So the Canaanites themselves were a group of people that were not of the, you know, the righteous seed, and they had a way unto wickedness. They'd like to, you know, they were wicked people, even from Cain himself, a murderer from the beginning, as Yahweh Shai said. So the Canaanites, the people of the Canaanites, beguiled Eve and taught her different philosophies and different understandings, and this is where this kind of the fruit of the tree of life. You see, the trees are represent, often in the Bible, represent peoples, and the fruit of the tree, what's the fruit? What do people bear? Well, one of the things that people bear, you know, what people accumulate together, what societies, what cultures accumulate, is knowledge. And the fruit of this tree is this kind of wicked left-hand knowledge, which the Adamites and the Evites, or the people that served the Adamites and were helpful to the Adamites, they were they were forbidden to, you know, partake in any of the other practices, maybe child sacrifice or whatever kind of weird, wicked things that these Canaanites were doing. They were forbidden it, but they were beguiled, you know, and the serpent, which is the seed of Cain, the people of Cain, this culture that existed at the time, were beguiled Eve and told her that if she did, you know, follow these practices, maybe it was astrology or Christology or some kind of Wiccan, left-hand, occult, Gnostic, blah, blah, that she could, you know, she would know both good and evil, and she would know that, you know, there is a left-hand side, and she would know that, you know, ways to manipulate the elements or do something. But when when they did that, they found themselves in a lot of hot water, because they realized that, you know, there was this left-hand side. They realized that there was sin, and they realized that they were in this world of good and evil, and, you know, this kind of, oh, I say good and evil, but of righteousness and wickedness, and that there is a path in wickedness, in order to get through wickedness, in order to get riches, in order to get what you want, and there's a path in righteousness in order to get wickedness and to get what you need. And she was beguiled, and she gave Adam, she told Adam, you know, about these practices as well, and they both fell. So that's quite a lot, but we have to understand basically the basic premise, and the thing that I kind of want to get through today is that in order to understand Genesis chapter 3 and chapter 5, you have to understand that there are there's the Most High, and then there's who was speaking through his prophets, really. And there was Adam and Eve, and these are representative of peoples. Adam was the high priest set, just like Esau is. You know, people, we talk about Esau as a people, or we talk about Israel as a people. We talk about Adam, and that was a people in Genesis, and Eve was the church of the people. These are the people that were ministers unto the priests, and then we had the prophets. So that's why it says things like male and woman, female, he created them, right? Because the people of Israel were male and female, and later on Adam, you know, the high priests and that set mixed their seed with the people of Israel, and thus came these two peoples, the sons of the righteous, which were through Seth, after Abel was slain, and the sons of the wicked, which were through Cain, and the Canaanites, Tubal Cain, I think there was Enoch, and all these wicked people. Lamech, I think, was another one. You know, they practice wickedness, and what has been happening is there's been a purification and a splitting at each time. You see, when Adam and Eve mingled their seed, two peoples came out, Cain and Seth, and the sons of the wicked. And then again, if we follow the line of the righteous, through to Adam, through to Noah, through to Abraham, Arphaxad and Abraham, Isaac. When Isaac had two sons, again, he had Esau and Jacob. Again, that line came out, and there's been a purification of this line since it's been mingled. The line had to be, and it's in the scriptures, the line had to be tainted somewhat. Oops. The line had to be tainted a little bit for us to understand the good and the evil. But then there's been a purification over time. Each time the it's like that film Twins, if you've seen it back in the 80s, Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito. One person gets all the good and one person gets all the bad. And then the line continues for purification. And then again, even through King Solomon. Solomon was somewhat tainted, you know, was Yahawashai going through that same process, going through the knowledge of good and evil. And then finally, at the end, you know, coming through as the Redeemer and the Savior. Anyway, I think that's a lot. It's a lot. And I probably need to break it down more simply. But I'll be going through it in more depth, bringing out more scriptures. But for that, for now, I'll say Shalom. Before I go, I just want to remind everybody, Yahweh is the name of the Heavenly Father, it means He is. Yahweh Shai is the name of His Son, it means He is, He says. Raha Kadash is the name of the Holy Spirit in Hebrew. Shalom.